What is entropy? Entropy is one of the most complicated concepts in physics. To have an idea, have a look at what the Second Law of Thermodynamics tells. The entropy of an isolated system can never decrease over time. It doesn't sound clear at all, right? Let's dig more into this and see if we can understand better what is entropy. What is entropy? As a first approach, we can say that entropy tells us what is the degree of disorder of a system. Unfortunately, this is not a very precise definition. First of all, order and disorder are ambiguous and subjective concepts. How can we say if a system is more or less ordered? Is a glass of water at room temperature with ice blocks inside more or less ordered than the same glass a few hours later when all the ice is melted? We could be tempted to answer that the latter is more ordered. But actually, this is wrong. The entropy of the liquid water is higher than that of the water mixed with ice. In nature, there are some systems that arise spontaneously and seem to be more ordered, even though their entropy increases. For example, if you mix oil and water in a container, and you leave it there for a while, you will observe a layer of oil forming above the water, and you will be tempted to say that the system is more ordered because oil and water are separated from each other. In reality, during this process, the entropy of the system has increased. So yes, entropy and disorder have some link. However, this is only true on a very superficial level, and there is some risk of confusion. There are better ways to define entropy. The easiest one is to think about heat and energy. In fact, there are some processes we are very familiar with and that we can use to describe entropy. For instance, if we take a hot object and a cold one, and we put them in contact, heat will move from the former to the latter, and not the other way around. Indeed, scientists in the past formulated the second law of thermodynamics based on this example. Heat never moves spontaneously from a cold body to a hot body. But wait, a refrigerator works exactly in the opposite way. It removes heat from a cold environment and gives it off to the room, which is warmer. That's true, but the key word here is spontaneously. The refrigerator doesn't do that spontaneously, because it needs some external energy in order to work. In fact, if you unplug the refrigerator, heat will go back moving the usual way, from the warm place, the room, to the cold one, the refrigerator. So to summarize, if there is a difference in temperature between two bodies, this difference tends to even out spontaneously. This means that the heat moves spontaneously from the hot body to the cold one until the two of them reach an equilibrium, and at this point, heat is no longer transferred. This natural fact can be exploited, for instance, to make an engine work. In fact, we can use a source of heat to make a motor or a turbine running, but this only works until there is a difference in temperature between the source of heat and the environment. The engine works because it is placed in the middle of this temperature difference, and the heat flows through it. Once the equilibrium is reached, the motor stops working. The problem here is that a flow of heat from the source to the environment cannot be inverted perfectly. For instance, I cannot use all the energy produced by the motor to keep the heat source hot. If it was possible, we could create perpetual motion, a dream for every crazy scientist. Similarly, it is not possible for heat to move spontaneously between two objects at the same temperature. This does not happen either. It can only happen if we use some energy from outside, as from the refrigerator. When physicists in the 1800s started to study heat, they did it with the purpose of understanding how to realize more efficient engines, and therefore they introduced the concept of entropy in order to describe how much energy could be extracted from a certain energy source. In other words, entropy gives a measure of how distant a system is from its condition of equilibrium. Two bodies in contact with each other have a low entropy, and as heat moves from the hotter to the colder one, entropy increases. When the objects reach the same temperature, entropy is maximum. Somehow, we can say that entropy is a measure of how concentrated the energy of a system is. As energy disperses in the surroundings, entropy increases. For instance, a piece of coal originally has all the energy concentrated in it. When we burn it, however, this energy is released into the environment as heat, and we cannot get it all back. Entropy has increased. So far, so good. This is a good way to understand entropy, but we can do even better. When we think about heat, we shouldn't see it as a magic substance flowing between two bodies. At microscopic level, the temperature of an object is related to the speed at which atoms and molecules move inside the body. But then, why a hot object tends to become colder and not the other way around? It's a matter of probability. At the end of the 1800s, the physicist Ludwig Boltzmann understood that entropy has to do with the number of possible ways in which the atoms and molecules of a system can be arranged without changing the macroscopic properties of the system. Well, okay, that doesn't sound very clear. Let's try to understand it by using an example. Let's imagine to have a gas consisting of six identical, undistinguishable atoms enclosed in a box. These atoms are moving randomly, bouncing off the walls in all directions. At every instant, each atom can be found either on the left half of or on the right half of the box. Now, let's imagine that all six atoms are initially on the left side of the box. How many possible ways can we arrange the atoms to get this configuration? The answer is, only one. In fact, since all the atoms are identical, it doesn't matter if we swap one with the other. We still have the exact same configuration with all six atoms on the left half of the box. Let's now ask instead, how many ways do we have to obtain a configuration with one atom on the right side and five atoms on the left side? In this case, we find that there are six possibilities. In each of those, we put one of the six atoms on the right half and the other five on the left half in rotation. By continuing this process, we will find that the configuration having more ways in which you can arrange atoms is the one with three atoms on the left and three atoms on right. In fact, the atoms can be arranged in 20 different ways to get this particular configuration. What does it mean? In terms of probability, it means that if I look at the gas in the box at a specific instant, the probability of finding three atoms on the left and three atoms on the right is 20 times higher than the probability of finding all atoms on the left side. To formalize this idea, Boltzmann wrote that the entropy of a system can be written using a specific formula, which is even written on his grave, S equals K log W. In this formula, the parameter W tells indeed how many ways particles can be arranged in to get the same configuration. In the previous example, W equals 1, when the six atoms are all on the left side, and in this case, S equals 0, which means that the entropy is 0. Instead, the entropy is maximum when the six atoms are split half and half, because in this case, the six particles can be arranged in the maximum number of ways, W equals 20. This is why entropy always tends to increase. If you start with a state at low entropy, for example, when all atoms are on the left side, it will be much more likely to find the system in a configuration with higher entropy later. In the example, the situation in which we have three atoms on the left and three on the right. This is even more true if we take a system where the number of particles is much larger than just six. For instance, if we had 100 atoms in the box, the probability of finding half of them on the left and half of them on the right side would be 10 to the 29th power times higher than the probability of finding them all on the same side. And for 1,000 particles, this probability would even be something like 10 to the 600th power times higher. And if you think about it, the usual number of atoms or molecules in a certain amount of matter is even much larger than 10 or 1,000. For example, the number of molecules of air inside a room is in the order of 10 to the 26th power, so you can easily understand why we will never see all the air in a room moving spontaneously towards one side of the room. It's extremely unlikely. In reality, things are more complicated than this. In the example of the box, we have taken into account only the position of the atoms. However, we should also consider the speed and the energy corresponding to each of the microscopic configuration. For example, taking the same gas as before, if we have a situation in which particles on the left side are on average faster than those on the right side, it would mean that we have different temperatures on the two halves. As time passes, the atoms of the two sides will keep moving randomly. Therefore, they will tend to mix, and so the energy will redistribute equally on the two sides of the box. So at the end, the particles on the two sides of the box will have on average the same speed. This also means that we no longer have any difference in temperature. We have reached equilibrium. The main point of all of this is that energy tends to move from a state more concentrated to one more diffused. This is because there are countless ways in which this could happen. And when I say countless, I really mean a huge number. That's why we will never see heat moving from a cold body to a hot one. Technically, it is not possible. However, the probability is so close to zero that this will not happen during the whole lifetime of the universe. Seeing entropy in terms of probability also helps us to understand some phenomena that seems to go in the opposite direction, such as oil and water that separate from each other, or even the birth of living organisms. There is no magic. If you do the calculations, you will see that the total entropy is increased, even in these processes. We can also explain the evolution of the universe in terms of entropy. At the beginning, after the Big Bang, all matter was a gas of particles almost uniform. But nowadays, the universe contains objects such as stars, galaxies, and even something extremely complex such as life. This seems to contradict the gas example, in which particles tend to go towards a more diffuse state. However, we are forgetting an important factor that plays a key role here, gravity. Gravity tends to aggregate matter, not to disperse it. So an initially uniform cloud of gas tends to evolve into a less uniform object, a star, without violating the second law of thermodynamics due to the action of gravity. Moreover, the star will be hotter than the surrounding space. And if there is a planet around the star, the temperature difference between the two of them will favor the inception of many complex processes, such as the birth of life on the planet, exactly as it happens in a motor. All of this goes in the same direction, an increase in the total entropy, no exception. This is why Sir Arthur Eddington once said that the second law of thermodynamics holds a supreme position among the laws of nature, and if there is another theory going against this law, it has no chances to be correct. So I hope this is now more clear. The increase in entropy of the universe does not mean necessarily disorder or death. In fact, there is room for doing much more in between, even creating life. This video ends here. Thanks for watching, everyone. Did you find entropy an interesting topic? Is there something more you want to hear about it? Let me know in the comments below. Be sure to subscribe, and I'll see you next time on the channel.